Thank you for watching Scary Animal Attacks. If you like this episode, please remember to hit the like button and leave a comment or two. Then subscribe and click on the bell to receive notifications whenever we release new episodes. Welcome back to Scary Animal Attacks. Today's episode takes us to the subtropical paradise of fun in the sun, Fort Lauderdale, Florida. The sunny waters and warm sands bring out the people in the droves to soak up the UV rays and splash their cares away. Amongst all of the hustle and bustle, the animals have to navigate their way while they find food and mates, but sometimes these two worlds collide in a very impactful and profound way. On November 19, 2001, 31-year-old Leon Resnick was basking in the sun and bouncing over waves while piloting a modified sea craft for a customer of his. He was a resident of nearby Hollywood, Florida, and a crack service tech at his job. He was working at the Riva Yamaha shop, and the guys at the shop tune up machines for customers and then get to take the crafts out on the water for a test run to make sure they work. Leon opened up the throttle as the air swept his hair back, and across the water he shot. He went back and forth on the lake and gunned it a few times, making sure to give the engine a little stress test, and it was pretty fun too, I'm sure. Now, Leon was no rookie on the water. He tested these upgrades and repairs out for customers every time they were performed, so he knew how to handle the speed of the machine, and slicing through the waves as he bumped and jumped in the agile craft was like a ballet to a ballerina for him. As Leon sped across the water, the fellas at the shop watched intently, and perhaps a bit enviously. They knew their primary job, as Leon tested the craft, was to measure his speed with a radar gun and make sure its top end was fast enough for the customer, or where it should be at least. Leon was flying at what his coworker thought was about 55 miles per hour. While Leon opened up on the throttle once again, his coworker bent down to pick up the radar gun. As he stood up, Leon was nowhere to be seen. He could see the craft meandering as it slowed, but no Leon. He scanned the water's surface, thinking perhaps Leon had somehow fallen off of the craft, but couldn't find him anywhere. It took only a few minutes of searching before they hopped on a craft themselves and began canvassing the water for him. They piloted their craft toward the direction Leon was last seen. They began searching for him by going in circles and going slowly over the area while looking into the water. The first tense minute passed, and they couldn't see him waving at them. They would make another round and repeat this searching technique, but he was still missing. After several minutes of searching, Leon's unconscious body was located and pulled aboard the craft and immediately sped toward the shore. CPR was performed on him in an attempt to keep him alive until medical professionals arrived. Leon was rushed to the hospital, where resuscitation efforts were unsuccessful. He slipped away there and was pronounced dead. While at the hospital, and probably before, Leon's rescuers couldn't have helped but notice the damage done to his face. It wasn't anything horrific, but there was definitely some bruising in places. Since there weren't any direct witnesses, though, at least none that had come forward yet, they didn't really piece together just what happened to Leon, other than he was found unconscious in the water. Afterward, the authorities in the area began to investigate the events that led to Leon's death. Given the details his co-workers provided, they figured there must have been something more to this event than an experienced operator falling off of a machine. That is when they got info about the machine he was riding after it was brought back to shore. The guys who retrieved it pointed out that there were several duck feathers stuck to the handlebars of the machine. And, while they were retrieving the machine, they found a mutilated duck floating nearby, which they collected and handed over to the authorities. After putting two and two together, they figured out that as he zipped across the water, the duck must have flown into his path and struck the handlebar area of his machine, then ricocheted upward into his face, rendering him unconscious from the impact, after which he fell into the water and drowned after suffering blunt force trauma to the head, which is what was later confirmed by the Broward County Medical Examiner's Office in his autopsy report. I know this seems like an incredible event, but here are the numbers. If Leon was traveling 55 miles per hour, which his co-workers estimated he was, let's assume the duck weighed about 12 pounds, that's about 5 kilos, which is in the normal size range for ducks. We can plug the values that we have into the same formula that you were taught in 8th grade science class for Newton's first law of motion, which is force equals mass times acceleration. Now you can see that we'll get roughly about 255 newtons. And what the heck is a newton? Well, it's a term used to express force, and all you really gotta know is that the human skull can fracture with only 73 of them.
Granted, converting 55 miles per hour does not directly plug in as an acceleration in the equation, but it gives you a good idea just how deadly a normal-sized speeding duck can be. Thank you for watching Scary Animal Attacks. If you like this video, please consider hitting that like button and clicking on the bell icon to keep you notified of our latest video releases. Sharing our video links on your social media might help save a life and spread the fun. As a member of our human network, be careful out there, because you don't want to end up on an episode of Scary Animal Attacks.